I'm honored to be part of this excellent symposium in the CARTA tradition, and I'm going to talk about the three smokes in the evolution of the human exposome. My thinking in this area began 25 years ago, three decades, in writing an article on the genetics of aging with Rudy Tanzi. We were both astonished that the heritability of lifespans was so low in humans and animals at the maximum of 30%. And the minor effect of genetics on lifespan implies that the environment profoundly modifies aging with multiple gene-environment interactions. In the last 25 years, I've focused on environmental factors in dementia, particularly air pollution as it interacts with the brain and brain aging. Another part of my thinking in this area was with an article that I wrote with Ben Trumbull in 2019, describing the phases of inhaled toxicants in human history. And particularly, we focused on the point that in the Paleolithic, before H. sapiens, our predecessors were exposed about a million years ago, began to be exposed to domestic smoke. And then, of course, in the industrial, more modern age, there was the introduction of smoke from fossil fuel, tobacco, and increasingly from wildfires. The point is that these are sequentially cumulative, and the future exposome will increase fossil fuel exposure and warming and ozone. Let's look at their chemical composition. So we have a great deal of data on roadway smog, and cigarette smoke has been analyzed in great detail, and wildfire is being increasingly analyzed. They all contain gas and gases, ozone, and oxides of nitrogen sulfide, and in the case of cigarette smoke, carbon monoxide. And then the amount of metals varies between them, but particularly for wildfires when houses are burned and the lead in paint is released. But all of them contain polycyclic organic compounds that are carcinogens, and all of them in the end come from partially combusted vegetal material. Fossil fuels, cigarette smoke, and wildfire. So there's a common chemistry in these that would predict that they do common pathology. The global mortality, as calculated for 2021, is about 8 million excess deaths from air pollution, calibrated as particles of 2.5 microns, PM2.5, that are shared with cigarette, and landscape fires and wildfires are just 1.5 million, much smaller. So all three of them have been identified with increased risk of dementia. The data on this is extremely strong for air pollution. And cigarette smoke has been long recognized, and wildfire smoke most recently in a paper that's of top level. So each of them has a dose-dependent increase on risk of dementia, and dementias include vascular as well as Alzheimer's. So we have a quantitative pathology in environmental causes as a designated cause of Alzheimer's that is will interact with genes, as I'll describe in a moment. So the point is, besides dementia, that air pollution accelerates normal brain aging. A study from USC that I'm not part of 10 years ago showed that three components of air pollution that are shown in the gradients around Los Angeles on the left hand, each of them has a different impact on cognitive aging in normal people living in residences. So these are a typical urban population, multiracial. Now, further evidence of importance for the air pollution is that, and dementia, is that recently J.C. Chen and colleagues at USC have published older U.S. women in communities that had former worse air that was improved in the prior 10 years, and their cognitive status is younger by about 1 year for both general cognitive status and episodic memory, maybe a little bit better improvement even for episodic memory. So this makes the important point that environment can improve and the effect on dementia decreases. So there are genetic effects on response to smoke. In our species, a great deal has been observed about the apolipoprotein E alleles, which evolved more or less at the same time as our species, H. sapiens, 2.5 million years ago. But there were two other genes that influence air pollution or are very likely to responses that evolved before our species. One of them is Siglec-16, sialic acid-binding protein, and one of the alleles definitely increases damage from cigarette smoke, and the aryl hydrocarbon receptor is a likely candidate for air influences on air pollution. So then the first example of air pollution, the common alleles, APOE4 and APOE3, there's a study that I was part of a decade ago. We showed that APOE4 carriers, both two copies of APOE4, had roughly a doubling risk of dementia. And this has been documented in great detail. Here is a study from New York about 7 or 8 years ago. And for PM2.5 and for nitric oxide, the blue lines, which are APOE4 positive, show faster decline than the red lines, which are APOE4 negative. And this has been documented in great detail in recent studies. And air pollution and APOE4, moreover, decrease the volume of the hippocampus in older women, which is a seat of memory of great importance. So these have been studied in mouse models in a system developed by Konstantinos Tsiotis at USC. Mice exposed to, are exposed in cages to re-aerosolized air pollution components at constant levels, and we've defined this in great detail. And as little as 3 hours of exposure induces, at high traffic levels, induces systemic and brain inflammation. And yet, even 8 weeks of this causes and does not affect the health of the mice. They have no weight loss and no organ pathology. So we have a quantitative system to approach these complex questions. And looking at mice with the human APOE3 and APOE4 alleles, the APOE4 carriers have much greater levels of amyloid after exposure in our model to air pollution. This has been taken further by Amin Haghani in my lab, and he compared wild-type mice and mice containing APOE3 and APOE4 by targeted replacement, and there were major sex differences. Female mice in all of these different genetic backgrounds have roughly 2 to 4 times more gene responses than the males, and there's roughly equal numbers of genes that are increased or decreased. Hagani's gone on in great detail to analyze the biochemical pathways and transcription factors and defined this in terms of the activation of NRF2 and NFkB by air pollution. And the biochemical pathways we have are investigating in some detail, and the glutamate neurons seem particularly responsive. And these treatments increase the amount of brain amyloid production consistent with the increase of Alzheimer's disease. So there's a great deal of progress from the USC collaborators and others in a field that has now grown in the last 5 years to new targets in biochemical pathways to protect against Alzheimer's from environmental causes. One of the drugs we just studied recently is a new anti-amyloid drug, gamma secretase modulator 15606, and developed by the Tansy team. And as you can see, in the filtered air relative to filtered air, or two different air pollution components, NPM or DEP, the level of A beta was elevated, and that elevation was blocked by this new drug. So the drug was designed to intervene for people in early stages of Alzheimer's, and now it may prove to have benefits to reducing the impact of air pollution on accelerating early stage Alzheimer's. So much more lies ahead in this discovery pathway. I'd like to now turn to exposure earlier in life, and it turns out that there are damage from gestational exposure we found in wild type mice, damaging adult brain functions that may predispose to dementia in humans. Most of particular interest are impaired adult neurogenesis or reproduction of new nerve cells in the adult. And I'll show you that data. And increased brain microbleeds, where hemoglobin gets into the brain and may enable the formation of amyloid aggregates around it or senile plaques. And then obesity is increased by air pollution and gestational. I'll show you those data. So here are data from our lab that the gestational exposure in normal mice decreased the number of new neuron formations in the adult hippocampus by about threefold, selectively for neurons and not astrocytes. And I mentioned obesity. This is now a recent study from Japan that smoking during pregnancy increased childhood obesity at age 5 relative to never smokers, women who smoked during but quit after birth. The childhood obesity was up 14%, and continuous smoking before and after was up nearly 40%. So the key point is that the common inhaled intoxicants, air pollution, and secondhand cigarettes have long-term consequences that begin prenatally. And at a molecular level, the strong paper just came out on the aryl hydrocarbon receptor, which I mentioned earlier. The DNA methylation of this gene is altered at three sites measured in the umbilical blood, and associated with children in these three sites, the methylation and AHRR, are associated with children's triglyceride levels and with HDL of long-term consequence to cardiovascular health. So the last point that I want to bring up, the last point is the air pollution and cigarettes have a synergistic effect or super additive effect. This was shown first for lung cancer, and it makes it 2.2-fold worse than either of them alone. And cognitive decline, 60% more, and body mass fat index, BMI, in children's health study, 30% higher. So we have a huge agenda ahead to understand the synergies, more of the synergies of tobacco and cigarette smoke, but also how these will interact with air pollution, which, as I showed you in an earlier slide, has definitive dose-dependent increases on dementia risk. So the future exposome for healthy brain aging is to minimize gerogens like air pollution, cigarette smoke, and wildfire exposure, and to optimize gene-environment interactions from development through aging. And I would like to close with just a cover of a book that I wrote 5 years ago that has a lot of background that is useful.